reminders, because it's always good to hear again. I wanted to share with you why we are so fortunate to have Khenpo Sherab Sangpo here with us today, and how fortunate we have been to have him here in the United States and Minnesota over the past 7 years. Khenpo has been a monk since the age of 7, has studied with some of the greatest masters in Eastern Tibet at a time when the Dharma nearly died in Tibet. His main root teacher is Khyentse Rinpoche, who he studied with as an attendant and, as I would think of, as an apprentice from a young age. He also has another root teacher called Jigme Khunstok Rinpoche, one of the most well-known Rinpoches and lamas from Tibet, and his third root teacher is Adzen Drukpa Rinpoche. Khenpo has been schooled in the Nyingma tradition of Tibetan Buddhism, most specifically the lineage coming from Sechen Monastery, and then even more specifically from Mindroling Monastery. He has also been fortunate enough to receive even a month-long series of empowerments from Dilgo Khyentse Rinpoche when he was studying and living at Sechen Monastery for about a month in the early 90s. So he's very well schooled, very well trained, and has had all the empowerments needed to present us the Dharma. In addition to that, we are fortunate enough to have a teacher who is very kind. He's named this Sangha Bodhicitta Sangha, and as we most all of us know, Bodhicitta stands for someone with a kind heart or a kind mind, both at the absolute level and at the aspirational and application level. As I said, he's been coming here for 7 years, and he has unfailingly taught the Dharma to us and has showed every kindness to every student and makes his home open to everyone at all times and is willing to answer any questions or work with anyone on any question that they may have. So once again, we are very fortunate to have him here with us. And just as a reminder, one of the books that Khenpo teaches from, and maybe even some of our teachings today, will come out of Patro Rinpoche's The Words of My Perfect Teacher. So I wanted to say a few things in general about what it is to have a great teacher. And if it all boils down to one point, what should you look for in a great teacher? But in general, an extraordinary teacher is one who gives the pith instructions, has received empowerments, kept the samayas, and is peaceful, has mastered the meaning of the ground, path, and result tantras, has all the signs of approach and accomplishment, and is freed by realization, has limitless compassion and cares only for others. He has few activities and thinks only resolutely of the Dharma, is weary of the world, and leads others to feel the same, is expert in methods and has the blessings of the lineage. Follow such a teacher and accomplishments come swiftly. And then, once we get to the point of examining the teacher, and I know that most of us have done this and would say resolutely at the Khenpo that he has this one qualification. To examine the teacher in general sense means to check whether or not he has all the qualities described in the sutras and tantras. In particular, what is absolutely necessary is that he should have bodhicitta, the mind of enlightenment. So examining a teacher could be condensed into just one question. Does he or does he not have bodhicitta? If he does, he will do whatever is best for his disciples in this life and in the lives to come, and their following him cannot be anything but beneficial. So with that, Khenpo, thank you once again for coming and teaching us, and we can't wait to hear the Dharma and more about Guru Yoga.
First of all, I would like to say thank you for coming. To Guru Yoga teaching, all of you, thank you very much for coming. And one day is practice. Can you hear back there? Can you hear me? Okay. If you can't, you can move here a little bit, sort of. And I'm very happy to have this good opportunity to talk and practice Guru Yoga with all of you. This is second, third, how many times we have been practicing Guru Yoga? Probably like fourth time, fifth time. Let's see, one, two, three, for, I think, five. This is fifth, right?
First one in 2007.
First one was 2007 with Colander. Two times with Colander, he translated for me. And then three times, probably here. So fifth time. So that means you really understand how to practice Guru Yoga. Very, very profound. This is very profound. It is a Buddhist practice. So, first of all, one of the most important is always, I say, correct your motivation. Before we practice meditation, practice Guru Yoga, before you listen teaching, you have to correct your motivation, your intention. According to Buddhism, this is very important. So you should feel I'm very fortunate to have this perfect sort of human life, preciousness, in which I have the opportunity to practice, right? Opportunity to practice. So in this retreat will benefit for myself and also for other beings. So this is, you have to think that. You have to think that, and this is how you correct your motivation. And this is how you practice Mahayana, a great vehicle, your motivation. I always think that the most important thing is practice meditation in our life. That's the most important. All the causes of happiness and suffering, most we think about the causes of suffering is attachment, Attachment is very difficult to diminish for just an ordinary person like us. Once we have attachment, really difficult everything in our life. Just to let go, but it's difficult. I don't know why I say that. But first, you really need to correct your motivation, okay? Love, and I think people, maybe I'm wrong, but I think people thinking that attachment and love kind of, they think they're kind of pretty much same. That's, I think, big mistake, misunderstand. If we say diminish your attachment, and then they think, how about my family, how about my property, all that kind of things there, you know. So the idea of diminish the attachment, I don't know, but we'll talk that more later. And the first of all, you have to correct your motivation. Second of all, you have mind free from conceptualization. Our sort of, which means to practice without distraction. And practice without losing focus. For example, if you let calm lots of your thoughts, right? Then the problem is they destroy your inner peace. Then you will lose your main sort of practice. Let's, for instance, today, like Guru Yoga practice, we have lots of visualizations, recitations, all this. But if you let come your thoughts, it will destroy your visualizations, your you know, practice. So that's why you, whatever you do, practice meditation, you should try to practice with a sort of concentrated mind and with sort of mindfulness, right? So that's the second thing. Second, very, very, this is also very good for your meditation. Just let go everything and just relax and focus on your meditation, okay? That's what we called free from conceptualization, right? That's the second. And then finally, of course, when we have done practice or listen teaching, whatever, whatever we do, sort of good things or virtues, we should dedicate for the sake of all sentient beings. So these three excellent or supreme methods, so important to remember always. In Tibetan Buddhism, all the teachers, when they start meditate or start teaching, they always teach these three supreme methods or three excellent methods, because doesn't matter you understand these three methods or not, always we have to talk about these things, because sometimes people forget, right? Correct motivation or free from thoughts and dedication. So this sometimes people forget. So that's why I kind of remind always, you know, important whenever you do practice. So these three, we call it, three supreme methods. And another thing important to understand is in order to learn and practice Dharma, we have to know the value of Dharma and the precious human life. These two things are very important to understand, very important to know the value of Dharma, especially people don't understand this, you know. How we are fortunate that we have these opportunities, right? We founded the great path. Because without Dharma, without practice meditation, our life is without sort of essence, I think. It really can't develop our happiness. Or meaning life without Dharma. That's why very important to understand the value of the Dharma, the benefit, you know. Then if you understand that, you really want to practice, you really want to meditate, right? So that's second thing, very, very important to understand. And in generally speaking, Dharma is, the Buddhism is very sort of profound and vast. We can't learn in all of them in this lifetime, that's for sure. I studied like 30 years, but I'm not finished yet. I can't learn in. I have to stop now and then meditate more, learning. Buddhism is just can't finish one lifetime, because very profound, especially the philosophy of Buddhism. We can't. So we have to, if we can't learn in everything, then we have to find something in Dharma that is really necessary for our life, the sort of the essence of Dharma that really help for our life. We have to kind of find that kind of things, you know, in Dharma. So, in generally, you know, the essence of Buddhist teaching is to avoid harm others, right, and help others as much as possible with pure motivation, right, intention. That's, I think, the essence, how to help others and also yourself, ourselves. That's the essence. But we have to develop this kind of motivation, right? Develop this motivation. Now, that kind of things, you understand the three supreme methods are very important, and usually in your life, you know, when you meditate, very important these three supreme. Then also very important to understand the benefit, practice Buddha Dharma, to practice Buddhism, the value of Dharma. Those very important. Just to let you know that. And then now I'm going to teach about Guru Yoga, which is the fifth inner preliminary practice. So what is the meaning of Guru Yoga practice? Guru Yoga, it means the sort of the union with the teacher's nature. Guru Yoga means the to integrate or blend your mind with the teacher's, right? Teacher's mind or nature. The mind is the most profound of all practice and the sort of shortest path to realization. Because, you know, this, the Guru Yoga practice, so important in Buddhism because the teacher says that there is not a single Buddha in the past, present, or in future who has achieved or will achieve enlightenment without relying on a spiritual teacher and without Guru Yoga. That's why we need to rely on spiritual teacher and receive his or her teachings and practice by the instruction we have received. So that's why it is very important. Pāpto Rinpoche, great master in Tibet, Pāpto Rinpoche, the Guru Yoga is called, you can see that in a word of my perfect teacher, he said, Guru Yoga is called a preliminary practice, but it is actually the key point in your main practice. Understand that? So it is so important to practice this. We call it preliminary, right? But it's not preliminary. It's always, this is the main, our practice. Pāpto Rinpoche also said that if you practice Guru Yoga correctly, recognition of your nature mind is possible. You have to know that you practice Guru Yoga correctly. The correctly word, that you need to understand, right? Without practice Guru Yoga, there is no way to the realization, no way get enlightenment. So, therefore, Guru Yoga is very important, right? The realization of nature mind because of the Guru Yoga. So therefore, if you understand the realized nature mind, enlightenment, right? That's what we call enlightenment, or the realization of everything is possible if you understand, if you practice correctly the Guru Yoga. I remember when I was in Tibet, my second root teacher taught us both kind of great perfection for 7 days. And the last day he told us, if you practice Guru Yoga with devotion towards the Buddha or your root teacher, then automatically you will understand the great perfection, which means the nature of everything. So Papa Rinpoche says that if you practice Guru Yoga correctly, then the realization is possible. The correctly means with devotion. This is very difficult. No devotion, practice Guru Yoga, not correctly. So, first of all, you have to develop, practice devotion. Without Guru Yoga and without devotion, you will never realize the great perfection. Never. Or nature mind. If you want to realize the nature of mind or nature of everything, then the devotion, the confidence, the trust, the devotion is the foundation. Sometimes people think if they practice Dzogchen or great perfection, they think they understand or they realize their mind, but they really don't have sort of devotion, then that's not great perfection. That's for sure. According to the instructions, according to the teaching, the great perfection, the what the master says that, you know, without devotion, there is no way to realize the nature mind, nature of everything, which means that in the heart sutta, we just say the form is emptiness. Emptiness is also form. Big subject. In order to understand that, you have to have devotion.
Could you say more about devotion? What does that mean to you?
I will explain that to you, okay? Yes, very important. The devotion is the essence of Guru Yoga practice. Why? Because this practice is called the recognition of nature of mind, transmission of blessing, or lineage of blessings. This practice we call, or to take the teacher's blessings as the path, or the blessed transmission of the ultimate. That's a Guru Yoga practice. So this practice is well successful or not, it really depends on your devotion. That means you have to understand about your Buddha nature, and you have to trust that you have potential or capacity to recognize it through sort of practice Guru Yoga. That's in general what is important, practice Guru Yoga, for practice Guru Yoga, or what is not important, practice Guru Yoga. So, now, in order to practice Guru Yoga, according to this, the ritual by Mopa Rinpoche, the actual practice of this profound path of Guru Yoga, there are three stages. The first, visualizing the field of merit. Okay? The second, offering the seven branches. And then third, the offering of prayer with one-pointed concentration. So we're going to practice these three stages today. So first is the visualization, right? So visualization about the Guru Yoga. Now, how we practice Guru Yoga? First of all, we need to start with visualization, okay? In front of you and in the sky, imagine a lotus flower. This is how you start the visualization. On that, imagine your root teacher, who in essence, the embodiment of the Buddhas of past and present and future, but who in form is Brahmasambhava. So this is in general how you start Guru Yoga, the visualization. But when you practice Guru Yoga, this is, I think, very important to understand for you, okay? In the sky, in front of you, pray to sort of whichever enlightened being inspires you the most. Remember this, okay? And consider that this being represents all of the Buddhas, Bodhisattvas, and Masters. It is not really necessary to visualize only Brahmasambhava for the Guru Yoga practice if you don't want. Whichever enlightened beings inspires you the most, that's the most important, because this, I said, devotion, right? It's the essence of this practice. So if you think Brahmasambhava, usually when we practice in Nyingma tradition, when we practice Guru Yoga, usually we practice with Brahmasambhava, right? But for you, it's a little bit difficult to understand or sort of visualize Brahmasambhava. Then I said, whoever enlightened being inspires you the most, you should visualize that in front of you. That's very important. Then easily you sort of develop your devotion, right? Even if you cannot imagine anyone form, actually, just to feel, you know, just to feel the present strongly and invoke his or her power or compassion and sort of blessing. Open your heart and really ask for help. Understand that there is someone who is absolutely, absolutely there for you, who understands you with love and compassion. If you trust and have a strong devotion, then absolutely someone is there for you. You will get blessings from these holy beings, enlightened beings. So, you know, it is not necessary to visualize about Brahmasambhava. Devotion is like a hook, and this holy enlightened being, the master, is like a ring, right? So ring and hook work together, right? Without missing one of these, hook or ring, then it doesn't work. It's like that. Your devotion or faith or whatever you call it is hook. And then this holy being or Brahmasambhava or enlightened beings, compassion is like a ring. And then both these cause and conditions together, definitely, absolutely, you get blessings, which means you will realize the nature of your mind, nature of all phenomena. One of these missing, then there is no way, no way to understand the nature of all phenomena. So for us, the student, very important to have a hook. And this holy being, Padmasambhava or Buddha or Bodhisattvas, whatever you call it, whatever you believe, they definitely have compassion. We don't have to worry about that. For that side, no problem. For us, very difficult to have a hook, which means devotion. Yeah, the rain.
Okay.
Beautiful diamond or gold rain above you. Very high, and you really want that. How you find that? It's very high. You can reach that, right, without hook. So that means really there is a beautiful, you know, like a golden rain. Like compassion rain. We need that. We need understand, people really think we need understand the nature of mind, nature of all phenomena. Right? People like that, to realize that, because that is the best quality we have. In order to find that, in order to have that, Guru Yoga practice is so important. So let's say, now, just I told you, keep that in mind. Whoever enlightened beings you believe and important to you, you should visualize that today in front of you, okay? But usually, when we practice Guru Yoga, we practice with Padmasambhava, right? Because he is, we call, second Buddha. And he is very important for Tibetans, especially. So, you are practicing, this Guru Yoga practice, is Tibetan Buddhism, right? There's all kind of Buddhism, but this is Tibetan Buddhism. Why we practice Guru Yoga with Padmasambhava? Because he's second Buddha and he's so important for Tibetan Buddhism. So you start by visualizing a lotus above your head. On the lotus is usually, you know, the sun disk and moon disk, which represent the union of compassion and emptiness, right? As usual. On top of its sit Guru Padmasambhava or Buddha or whatever, green Tara, you know, whatever you like to visualize, okay? And according to what my perfect teacher or the Khyentse, we call the preliminary, you also imagine yourself in the form of Vajrayogini. You have picture. Because there are many reasons you visualize Vajrayogini yourself, but it is the symbol of your nature mind, actually. because Vajrayogin is kind of naked without clothes. Similarly, your nature mind, naked without any obstacles or afflictions. But if you like to visualize just being your, you know, ordinary person or ordinary body, that's no problem. That would be no problem. You don't have to visualize Vajrayogini. Okay? If you like to visualize Vajrayogini, of course, no problem. But if it is difficult, then you don't have to visualize yourself as Vajrayogini form, okay? So now you have visualization of Pammasambhava or somebody in front of you and the sky, right? And just thinking that surrounded by the entire lineages. You don't have to visualize specifically, but you just think that, you know, lineage like this. I have a picture here. Like this, you know. For instance, this is above your head, like in front of you, or, you know, in the center, you visualize Pammasambhava, and then surrounded by him, there, just this is kind of give you an example, right? We have lots of teachers around him. You don't have to visualize one by one these teachers. You can't, right? But you just visualize they're there. Okay? That's second things. Second you visualize. You just, they're there, all your lineage, they're there. It's so important, but I will tell you, I will teach you why it is important to think about your lineage, okay? So, once you've done that, this vision, it's very easy. Someone who really believes you and someone really you like, you visualize that there, and then also your lineages. Everybody has a lineage, right? Everybody has a teacher. And then teacher has a teacher. So that's your lineage. You don't have to visualize my lineage. You don't have to visualize somebody. Whatever you have, your lineage, your lineage, you should visualize that, that they are there. So because this is, the guru means teacher, right? Yoga means practice, actually. So you're practicing your lineage. So that's why you have to visualize that there. And then once you've done that, once you have that visualization, then you can start the recitation of the Guru Yoga ritual. And most importantly, practice with seven-line prayers. And after the seven-line prayer, you will recite the Pammasambhava's mantra, the 12-syllable mantra of Guru Pammasambhava. And this is what you actually accumulated 100,000 times if you practice Guru Yoga preliminary. But not today, you know. Not today, 100,000 times. And with the reciting the seven-line prayers and Guru Pammasambhava's mantra, then you also receive the blessings of his body, speech, and mind, wisdom mind, amazing, a very sort of beautiful rays of light stream out towards you from whatever you visualize there. Let's say Pammasambhava, okay? From him, and imagine that light as a nectar, wisdom, you know, satisfying your heart up completely. And then transform all your negative emotions, negative thoughts, into sort of bliss and happiness. That's about it. That's a Pammasambhava. That's the Guru Yoga practice. So you receive the, let's say this is a very important one too. So you receive the rays of light emanating from his three centers, right? How you visualize this? Three centers, three chakras from, let's say, Padmasambhavas, and also whole his body. So the lights, usually you have their letters, the syllable, or mahon syllables, the white and red, blue lights, right? White lights comes from, if you don't know the syllables and difficult to visualize, you don't have to, okay? Just to visualize three different color lights, that's fine, right? So the white light, for instance, comes from his or Padmasambhava's forehead into your forehead, right? And then the red is come from his throat and into your. Blue is come from his heart with the mind and through yours, through your heart. And when you receive this light, then simultaneously you will also be purified all obscurations of your body, speech, and mind. This is what we call empowerment. Which gives you sort of permission to receive the Vajrayana teachings and to practice them. If you receive the empowerment, then you can practice Vajrayana. Guru Yoga is part of practice Vajrayana, you know. And then at the end, visualize the lineage, you have their lineage, right? The lineage dissolve into Padmasambhava, or whoever you visualize, dissolve into that, the lineage, and then Padmasambhava sort of melt into light, and then light dissolve into you. Understand this? This is very important, okay? And think that your mind and Padmasambhava's wisdom mind merge and union, or what you call it, blend, right? That's what we call Guru Yoga. And then you should look deeply, not outwardly, but look deeply into your nature. And you recognize that there is a nature clarity within your non-conceptual experience. If you understand that, that's Guru Yoga. That's the main point. Bhakti Rinpoche said that nothing whatsoever, totally blank, blankness which is utterly open, a total openness which is indescribable. Recognize your nature. That is first vital point. Do you understand that? That is the Guru Yoga practice. That's your nature mind. Mahavira Rinpoche says, maintaining the resting in natureness and the awareness of knowing your essence of mind or the nature of mind is therefore an oral instruction. If you understand that, that's your nature mind. If you don't understand, I have no idea. You have to practice devotion, practice preliminary. It is almost impossible without practice preliminaries understand the nature of mind. Some people, if I say practice preliminary, at least 500,000 times the inner preliminary and outer preliminaries. People don't like that idea, but I don't care. And that's how you practice. If you want to practice Buddhism, that's how you, especially Tibetan Buddhism, that's how you practice. That's all these masters and, you know, teachers, Buddhas, Bodhisattvas came from. If you don't like that, don't practice Buddhism. I mean, you know. Some people say that to me, you know, you should not say that you're a student. Few people told me that. I didn't like it. You should not tell your student to practice preliminaries 500,000 times because then they will not come. I don't care. If they don't follow me, I don't care. If they really want to practice Buddhism, I won't practice preliminary. I give you this preliminary practice. That's the essence of Buddhism. That's how you understand the nature mind, you know. And also correctly practice 500,000 times these preliminaries correctly, not just counting, you know. Oh, okay, I'm done, 500,000 times, I'm done. But you have to check yourself how much change your mind, you know, how much you diminish your negative emotions and understand everything. These five preliminaries are amazing. It's just amazing practice. If you don't like practice that, don't practice Buddhism. I always say that. I don't care. You know, you should practice something else. There are so many things you can practice, right? But if you want to practice Buddhism, you have to practice this. Accordingly, you know, according to Nyingma lineage, according to my lineage, without practice preliminaries, there's no way to practice nature mind. Because you can look directly at the experience and its essence, right? If you practice Guru Yoga, and then without, you know, this Guru Yoga practice, you can't see this nature mind. Nature mind is enlightenment. It's so important. It's the liberation. If you understand this, I just give you today two quotes. This is very important. This is great perfection. One is from Pabdu Rinpoche, one is from Mepa Rinpoche. So, if you understand this, that is nature state of your mind. Untouched by any obscuration in which all phenomena are sensed as the Buddha see them. If you understand this correctly, you are no different than Buddha. You are Buddha. And here, thoughts do not give rise to any negative emotions or the accumulation of karma. And also, all good and bad circumstances are quickly transformed into path of enlightenment. Understand? That's the main point practice today, okay? First, we have to recite something and visualize something. That is not the point. It's the method. The point is resting in naturalness. At the same time, the awareness, the clarity, union of naturalness, union of the clarity and, you know, the natureness. So now we are ready to practice meditation, and we need to recite the ritual about Guru Yoga. This Guru Yoga practice is written by Mepa Rinpoche. And he is the most important teacher in Nyingma lineage. And he is the sort of incarnation of Manjushri. And his teacher were Pabdo Rinpoche and Njamang Khyentse Wangpo. Both sort of incarnation of Rinzen Jingme Langpa. Rinzen Jingme Langpa is the student, best student of Longchenpa. Longchenpa, you know, right? So that's Nyingma lineage. That's the most important teacher. Okay? Any questions? Do you understand? Yeah? Longchenpa is the the most important teacher in Nyingma lineage, and in Nyingma lineage, we learning Buddhist philosophy based on his teachings. And he has so many students, but the most important teacher is Rinzen Jingme Langpa. So therefore, the Longchenpa is the most important teacher in Nyingma lineage. We need to talk more of that later, okay? So you just need to think that your lineage is there. You don't have to think about specifically, you know. So now, the first is about the visualizations. Then we have to recite the seven land prayers few times. And then the seven branch offering, right? So you sort of invoke Pamasambhava or whatever. And then you visualize the offerings, the seven branch offerings to the Pamasambhava. And after that, there is another supplication. And after that, we have to recite Pammasambhava's mantra, Om Ahum Vajragura Pammasadhum, right? Maybe 100 times. And then the empowerments. Okay, ready?
In a self-manifest realm of infinite purity, I find myself visualized as Vajrayogini. On my crown sits a thousand-petaled lotus, a sun and moon, and Odhyana Vajradhara, union of all sources of refuge. He is white, tinged with red, with a peaceful smile, Vajra, Sulka, and Deus. He wears Sambhogakaya ornaments and is embraced by his partner, Yashodhaya. Self-arisen mandalas of Tantra are perfectly present in his form. Rooted in the liege gurus, Akinis, and the Olabhan, surround him like a pile of seeds split open. From Chamara continent come their bosom counterparts. Falling like rain, they dissolve into individualized support.
Just 1 second. Visualize whatever you want. So when you recite the seven land prayers with devotion, sometimes you can say, you can recite without visualization. Sometimes only, visualizations. If you can't visualize and recite, you can't both together, you can sort of alternately, you know, you can do this. The most important is when you practice Semalan supplication, if you understand Pamasambhava, he is there. Really, you just not looking for something outside. You just really need to feel your heart felt, right? Very sort of tangible, you know, Bambasambhava's compassion and his loving kindness. And through that compassion, you will get blessings, right? And then immediately, sometimes you get blessings. Sometimes when we meditate like that, you get a sort of goof, you know, like, you know, something you really, you feel that something is there. And then you just immediately look into, you know, very deeply nature mind. Sometimes it is really, the realization is possible through that blessing. That's why this is very important to practice, right? If you visualize something there, you feel nothing, that means you are not correctly practicing, right? You have to feel something. Sometimes you get something, I don't know, a kind of feeling or experience, something like, you know, really changed your mind or your body also, something, you know, what do you call it? Sometimes we get some goof in something. That means, huh?
Goosebumps,
that's correct. Yes. Goosebumps. That means really you are connecting with somebody. If you have no experience, feelings that, then you are not really sort of connecting with your teacher, with your guru. If you connect and you feel that, immediately just to, you know, stop that and immediately look into your nature mind. And you will see and understand the nature mind. And then you just sit there as long as you can. And then your thoughts arise and then do again. Okay? That's more very important. How was that?
In the northwest of the land of Bodhiana, in the center of the blooming lotus flower, is the one with supreme wondrous city, the renowned lotus form Padmakara, surrounded by a vast retinue of Dakinis. Following in your footsteps, I pray, please come and bestow your blessings. Guru Padma Siddhi Om.
Home
in the northwest of the land of Odiana, in the center of a blooming lotus flower, is the one with supreme wondrous city, the renowned lotus-born Padmakara, surrounded by a vast retinue of Dakinis. Following in your footsteps, I pray, please come and bestow your blessings. Guru Padma Siddhi Om.
Home
in the northwest of the land of Odiana, in the center of a blooming lotus flower, is the one with supreme wondrous city, the renowned lotus-born Padmakara, surrounded by a vast retinue of Dakinis. Following in your footsteps, I pray, please come and bestow your blessings. Guru Padma Siddhi
Home.
So you visualize all Buddhas, Bodhisattvas, Masters, Padmasambhavas there. Now we offer it, right? Offer to Buddhas, Bodhisattvas, this seven with the seven branch offerings, okay?
Oh, with infinite bodies I bow down, prostrating respectfully, and offer as Samantabhadra, apparent existence, the manifest ground. Every misdeed and downfall from all lifetimes I now confess, rejoicing in all the virtues throughout samsara and nirvana. May you remain as the Vajrakaya, as long as beings and realms exist. I beseech you to turn the wheel of the profound and vast Dharma, as I dedicate this whole host of virtue to the attainment of Buddhahood.
and Manetas
in fortress of the northern land of Odiana, dwells the emanation of the Sagata's body, speech, and mind. Come to the continent of Jambu for the welfare of beings, surrounded by a multitude of Vidyadharas and Akinis. I supplicate the divine assembly of Padmakara. I supplicate you, Padmakara, Guru of Odiana. Please grant me your blessings and empowerment.
Om Ahom Banzaran Guru Padma Sindhi
Om. Om Ahom Banzaran Guru Padma Sindhi Om. Ahom Banzaran Guru Padma Sindhi Om. Ahom Banzaran Guru Padma Sindhi Om.
Om Ahom Banzaran Guru Padma Sindhu.
Just to realize and your visualization are dissolving and to each other. And then you have to look directly into your nature mind. Maintain the resting in naturalness and the awareness of knowing your essence of mind. This it is. Maintain again the resting in the naturalness and the awareness of knowing your essence of mind. You understand that? That's your nature mind. So look directly into that.